This is Route.
I probably should actually have this channel.
And I am JT Norimaki, and with me today is Trenter TR and MadTez64, both runners of this games as well. Trenter is, and this is, you guys are going to laugh at me, but Trenter's our current world record holder for this category of running of all Magic Seals, so we're going to have a ton of fun here. At any rate, I don't know, I'm going to have them do all the talking about all the crap that's going to be going on while I try to focus and not die. Any rate, we're going to start up with a new file here, and I will count us down shortly. Basically, our time starts when I select the mode that I want to play in. I'm not doing magic mode because, no, that's meme. All right, guys.
Yeah,
so
magic mode. Oh, sorry.
No, go ahead, Tess. Go ahead, Tess.
I was going to say magic mode, you'd think is better because it gives you double magic, but it also halves your damage, and honestly, you don't really need a magic that, like, that much magic.
Yeah, and opposite what he said, it actually doubles your damage but halves your magic consumption.
Yeah.
So, any rate, I'm gonna go ahead and count us down, and then if you guys want to talk about why this freaking opening is so reset heavy, then we'll do that. So we're gonna go ahead and start this run here in 3, 2, 1, go.
Okay, so the reason, basically what he says, like, you're gonna see, if you watch any Shantae or Risky's Revenge run, you see that, notice this. There's a lot of time spent in this first minute. He has to grind for 40 gem, collecting the 10 gem right at the end of this section, because he wants to buy a pipe ball, which is 50 gems, and if he doesn't get it, he's basically gonna have to just go out of his way to grind for 50 gems. It's pretty, not a rare occurrence, but it's uncommon occurrence, so you see it will reset a lot for this.
It's an extremely common occurrence to reset here.
Oh no, I meant it's uncommon to get 50.
I will take 36. That's not bad.
Oh, that's fine.
Yeah.
The thing is, why we have to grind that is, you get 25 per se every time you go there. But the scarecrows are the RNG in this, because you need 15 gems by the scarecrows, and there are only like 8 or 13 scarecrows there, and they can drop everything.
Like, you saw he dropped a heart there, they could drop magic, big magic pots, everything. Alright, so so here he's getting the egg, just for like required story type things, if somebody wants to explain the story.
So yeah, story-wise, I mean, what's going on is Shantae is being attacked by monsters after her first adventures, whatever. You know, she's keeping the egg for Sky as a babysitting job. She basically raises warbirds for attack and whatnot. Anyway, we're picking up that egg before we go talk to Bolo really quick. And we go back and give it to her. And sure, everything's fine with said egg. That's no problem. Meanwhile, Mimic is showing off his most recent archaeological find. The whole story's a load of crap, and I mean that literally, as he talks about defecating in order to make sure that he doesn't trigger a trap. And the crowd is very impressed with how impressive his bowels are. We give that egg to Sky, and then Risky comes in and steals that lamp. So that's always a problem, and then we have to go and battle her by our house. So this is
extremely hard battle.
Yeah, this battle is so freaking hard. Like, I'm just tense. I'm nervous. I have no idea what to do right now.
It requires 40 frame perfect inputs.
Yeah.
Okay. No, it's actually just you just wait for the attacks. So like, no matter what, this battle is just gonna be like the same time. Do you guys want to explain all magic seals, or should I?
Yeah, go for it, Taz.
All right. So in this game, because of the story, you're expected to collect 3 magic seals in order to, I think it was to prevent Risky from collecting 3 magic seals. Yeah. So basically, there's three main quote-unquote categories of this game. Any percent, where you just skip pretty much everything. It's like a 20-minute long category. And you do a bunch of like annoying tricks to get to it. 100%, which you collect everything. So like an hour and a half. And this category is meant to be the middle category. So basically what he's going to do is he's going to collect go to three dungeons and then go straight to the final, warp to the final boss. There is another category that people have done before called Anime Percent No Out of Bounds, but if we did, it's basically, the thing about that is if we did that, we'd have to do a 5-minute auto scroller towards the end, right at the end of the run, and I don't think people enjoy watching that, and I don't think there's a lot people would enjoy running that. So.
All right, so Shantae just got fired from her job as the town's protector, so there's that. We're now jobless, and obviously we need some money to, again, buy that pike ball that was mentioned earlier. Again, this is kind of the grinding area, but I take this opportunity to go ahead and jump ahead of things a little bit by waking up that warp squid. It's kind of important, saves a little bit of time in this particular category whenever it comes down to the fact that you've now got to grind these 50 gems. Again, normally we just grind out or reset until we get the 50, and this is the best spot to do it. It's just a little less inconvenient. I'm getting some decent luck here. There we go, I got my 50, so we can continue. It wasn't a bad, I got the warp squid, I got my 50 gems pretty quickly, so we're not doing too bad from a time perspective. And if you guys could really quick just talk about kind of the movement tech of backdashing and leaving doors.
Yeah, because the game has certain animations. You always want to be as fast as possible. This game introduced us backdashing. And the thing is, backdash has no cooldown, so you can do it again and again, and it's the fastest way to move. But it requires always an input, like you have to mesh buttons right for that to do it perfectly.
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, so the whole backdash tag is challenging because you can lose several seconds if you don't do that and just walk.
Yeah, and there's also when he goes through like different doors. Oh, sorry. When he goes through like, well, not doors, but if he goes like from screen to screen, he wants to like run through them and not just backdash through them, because otherwise, what's gonna happen is he'll he runs from screen to screen. If he backdashes it, for some reason, he's just gonna walk through it. So he has to, like, that's kind of like another thing you have to keep in mind. And then there's also going through, like, certain doors. You wanna, like, jump and whip while you're going through them. If you're, like, exiting a building.
Yeah, it saves a walking animation of her actually walking out of the building. If you can whip the same time that you're hitting that exit frame for the building, It just makes her instantly be standing outside instead of having to deal with the walking animation. So it's important to try to get that as many times as you possibly can. And I just kissed a spider like an idiot, whatever.
Right now he's gonna go all the way into the... He talked to Roddy Tops because he wanted to collect the dog. Because in the next area, there's a lady who's missing her dog that Roddy Tops took. And you want to give it back to her, because then she'll give you food, which you can get to enter the first dungeon, so...
Yeah. And because we need gems, we're gonna kill the dog, because it has...
Oh, I wasn't gonna spoil food. That.
Oh, yeah, spoilers, Trent. Wow, dude.
Come on. Everyone knows that. No one likes dogs.
I love dogs. I'm a dog person, man.
I'm actually a cat person myself, but...
But this dog is actually just too hyper for its own good. We've got to put it down, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
It's just way too much. And besides, it makes the ending of Pirate's Curse extremely canon.
Yeah.
Rip.
That's such a great touch by WayForward.
Yeah, it is.
Okay, so... One thing you'll notice... Oh my god, I completely forgot what I was going to say. Wow. Oh yeah, the menus. You're going to see him struggle with the menus a lot. It's a really obnoxious type of, it's just really obnoxious to, like, select the right option. Because what happens, for the most part, is he, when you, like, have a yes or no option, it's defaulted to no. And it's like, you have to also skip through text, but, like, the same button to select yes or no is the same button to skip through text the fastest.
Yeah,
so you see a lot of times where we'll actually accidentally select no instead of yes. That pretty much happens to all runners.
Yeah, it's the biggest time save, I think, for all runners, but it's also the biggest annoyance for all runners.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also the start button, like you see oftentimes the menu popping up. It's because the whole text mashing is on the same key as you open the menu. And we don't know why, but it is.
Just lazy programming.
Yeah. At any rate, so we did the food delivery to Squid Baron, who basically just did a dine and dash. He didn't pay us for our delivery work. We're very pissed about this, so now we're going to hunt his ass down and try to take him out for that.
Yeah. How does he dare to not pay us? Come on. Let's see.
So, yeah, movement tech through this. This is the reason we needed the pike ball first. Like, it actually matters to have that pike ball because it saves you, what, this was like a minute and a half going through this dungeon, lab one, without the pike ball. I think it's actually quicker, and it definitely is quicker with the pike ball. So that's why it's so mandatory to get the 50 gems right up front.
It's actually possible to go through, like, it's possible to go through this game or this level with just the fireball, and like, it would save a lot of time at any percent because you could like jump up to the but it required by using the double fire jump or whatever it was called.
Yeah, the fireball double jump. Yeah,
it's an extremely hard trick, and I think it was like you have to do 4 in a row in order to skip a certain section.
It's 5. Wow. Yep, taking that slow. Alright, so I missed the one cycle here.
Aww.
But I didn't get wet, and that's the important part about wet room. That room can be your best friend or cause you a reset in an actual true attempt because of the fact that getting wet just eats up so much time. I missed the one cycle with the pike ball. Unfortunately, my timing was just off just a bit, but no worries. We didn't get wet, and that's the important bit. So we're going to move on. One thing to talk about here really quick with this particular dungeon, and I'm trying to remember, oh god, what the hell, she just ate a jump input, thank you, that was tasty. Now my cycle is way off here, alright. The platforms all basically kind of start moving when you get within proximity of them, so when you enter a room it doesn't start the movement, and I'll talk about that in just about a minute as we talk about certain things, but obviously, you can see why the pike ball is important. One, it handles these knights pretty decently. And two, obviously, it breaks blocks and things like that. And you're going to see a big case of that here as I get into the skull room. And why this pike ball is, you imagine trying to do this with just whipping tech. It would just be a huge annoyance. It would take forever, where the pike ball just makes it nice and simple. Plus, dealing with the monsters here. And what I'm trying to do with these dashes with the keys is a key dash. I'm not getting it, unfortunately. You save just a little bit of time because you pick up the key and you also move at the same time. I'm not nailing those.
Yeah, it's kinda sad. There are some keys where you still have the chance to do that. The whole sky room and the all block breaking, that's just so annoying doing without any pike ball. Lose so much time. That's the whole reason why we get why we always get the 50 gems in the beginning, to save a lot of time here.
All right, I got to be careful. I've got really low health going into night room, so I'm gonna hope that I get a heart there. Thank God I did. Now I'm feeling a little bit more confident about night room.
Yeah, the thing about dying in this game is if he loot, like, this game runs on saves, but it doesn't run on, like, autosaves, so, like, where you save, you'll have the exact same
health.
You respawn, you have the same health and location. So if he dies here, he'd have to be pretty much go from the beginning or whenever you last save. And he can't just use health saves to regain health or anything. So. Yeah.
The only thing that saves don't save are pots. The rest is all safe.
Alright guys, stone boobies and hologram booty. Let's do it. We're getting our first transformation.
Yay. Monkey.
Monkey!
Monkey!
This will be the primary transformation that we use throughout the entire run. It's actually pretty much the primary transformation throughout all categories, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
It just is what it is.
I would say elephant gets a lot of use.
It can later. I guess 100% it definitely gets a lot of showcasing, but...
Yeah, because you have to open several caves, though.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's true, I guess.
I'm just grabbing those hearts to be safe. Wow, slow monkey ascent, go figure. Alright, I'm grabbing this gem here because I need it for my next shopping sequence. It's very mandatory to pick that up. It'll be the only gem that we pick up throughout the entire run, though, as it's not necessary to pick up any of the other upgrades, but I do need it for my second pike ball, so very important that we grab that. And rather than going with wet room again, we're just going to skip it using the monkey form. It's awesome.
It's technically faster to go through it without monkey, but you'd have to you basically have to do the early cycle that JT mentioned earlier, which is pretty hard to do.
Yeah, and it's not one cycle, it's early one cycle. It's a bit harder though. You have to go very risky in that room.
Yeah, and you just have to go nonstop, which is that's pretty much the hardest room in the game, so.
Yeah, many runners for lost runs in there.
So right now he's just going into this little passage here, and he's gonna get one last key, and he's gonna go fight Squid Baron. What you're gonna see here is he's gonna try to attempt a thing called the quick kills, which if you guys want to explain that, be my guest.
Yeah, we would love to explain it if we actually knew how it worked. that's kind of the tricky part. So the quick kill is the way that you can save a ton of time, because fighting these bosses casually is just a nightmare. It takes for freaking ever to actually kill them. So fortunately, this trick has been found, and all we really can say or know about it is that it's a frame-perfect trick, and there are theories and theories and theories behind it. My personal favorite is an underflow theory, where basically you undercode the game because of too much things happening at the same time, and it doesn't know how to handle it, so it just says, okay, boss is dead, have your seal and move on. Oh god, I got the back row palette, I hate that. And Squid Baron is probably the hardest one. I will give this a couple of goes, but if I don't trigger the quick kill, we're gonna have to deal with this guy casually, and you'll see why it sucks fighting bosses casually. In this particular game,
I wouldn't say it's too bad. Like for this boss, it only costs it's like only a minute slower.
Yeah, it's like a minute or so. But oh, I died. All right.
Well, it's a good thing you just saved.
Yeah, that's why I saved before these quick kill attempts.
Yeah.
Anyway.
The thing is with quick kills, the bosses are down kinda instantly.
Mm-hmm.
And
oh my god, back palette again.
And the only thing you have to wait for is the seal to come down, and it gets you healed completely up again.
Nope.
But because it's frame perfect and it's inconsistent, because sometimes you are not in front of Squid Baron or other bosses.
He might kill me again here.
So you don't see yourself, because the way we trigger it is that we stop dancing and transform the moment we can get hit again, like the moment the invincibility frames are over. But seeing that behind him is a bit difficult.
All right, so I'm taking him out casually. This quick kill is not working. And he might still kill me, so we may still have another attempt at it, but it's just a difficult fight, and he's giving me some really bad RNG, too. Like, normally what I'd like to see is more of the kids and less of him teleporting, but we got him. He's dead. Unfortunately, we had to do it the scrub way, but I didn't want to waste too much time trying to get the quick kill, because you could literally spend 5 to 10 minutes actually trying to get it, or hours if you really are not good, so... Anyway, there's our first magic seal. We've now punished the Baron for doing a dine and dash on us and not paying us for food delivery, so he's now taken that, and all of a sudden now Risky Boots decides to show up. She goes, oh, well, you beat me to this, but I'll beat you to the next one, basically, is what she's saying, is I'll get the next seal before you. In the meantime, we don't really care about that. We're just going to move on, so... All right. Not taking any damage here, that's good. Well, till that troll orc decided to get in my way.
So right here, he wants to go to a very far on the other side of the map, but he's gonna actually make a shopping trip right after this. But before he does, what he's gonna do? Well, if he didn't have to grind for gens, he'd run all the way to the other to this to another teleporter.
Oh my god!
Patch area.
Sorry, menu issues.
Sorry.
I'm just having menu issues. No problem. Yeah. You already spoke to that, so.
Yeah. So basically, he's just gonna teleport right there, though. And when he teleports there, what's gonna happen is the game blocks you from going any farther by one of the main characters. We try to go towards this area though, because that guy actually gives you 100 gems as a bribe, so you can go meet the mayor.
Yeah, the guy who fired us at the beginning of the game wants to talk to us now suddenly.
Alright, so once he gets to the shopping trip, he's gonna buy a fireball, an electricity cloud, and some potions. And I think there's one other thing I forget.
But, level 2 pipe ball.
Level 2 pipe ball, because that makes things a lot faster. And he uses that one gem he got to get that. And the other two items are basically required for certain parts of the game, which you'll see later in the run.
Oh, missed it. That's fine.
Polyp Bay?
No, not quite Polyp Bay. I was just trying to hit the stuttered platforms right behind the lighthouse.
Oh, okay.
And just missed it by like 2 pixels, so it's fine. And now I'm in Polyp Bay, though.
Yeah, so you might see him screw this up a lot. This is probably one of the hardest parts for a lot of runners. There's a lot of like platforming, and like there's a lot of like platforms moving up and down. You have to like do a timing. Like, there's a way to do it first cycle, like without having to wait that much. But
actually, I'm actually doing it very well at the moment. So again, like what I was talking about with the platforms and how they operate in this game. So again, they're based on proximity rather than entering the room and having them start. What happens is you get to a certain distance away from them, and I've noticed that these platforms actually do their cycle once you get close. So the tricky part is if you drop any part in Polyp Bay, you're better off actually leaving to reset the cycle for them than trying to deal with it afterwards, because it does change so dramatically if you do miss a single jump. I got through it like perfectly clean, so that is probably as good a Polyp Bay as anyone could really get. I won't say it was perfect, but I'm not going to complain about what just happened there. So then we go get the mayor. He gives us this particular deed. And we've now got to go deliver it to Mr. Ammo Baron in the desert. So we're going to go back to Pumpkin Patch.
Yay, escort for delivery quest.
Yes, another delivery quest. Go figure. It seems like we're just Shantae's delivery service. That's what they should have called this game.
Nice. I like how you're just slowly going to menus because you don't want to deal with them right now.
I don't. I'm so over menus. After like a month of practice in this game, I'm so done with menus.
Yeah, and if you do, if you are too fast in menus, you can even soft lock your game.
Yes, there is. Oh yeah, I did want to talk about that. Thank you. That happens to me all the freaking time. If you do too fast menus, you get to this point where you get something called a menu glitch. And that menu glitch means you can't go into menus, period. So, the only way to rectify it, certain areas will allow you to just transition screens and fix it, but more often than not, you have to go into a freaking cave and back out in order to get menus to actually come back in the game. So, good luck with that if it happens. It actually can be a huge killer of the run if it happens, say, in Polyp Bay. Oh, I gotta be careful here.
That means if you get some menu glitch, he can't save, he can't...
I can't save, can't, go, can't get in my items, can't do anything.
No, he can't do anything. He has to play, which is not bad, but you can't talk with the delivery guy, for example. And all this stuff.
Oh, really quick, can you guys talk about pot duplication?
Basically when you... for some reason this only works with like 2 or 3 pipe balls, and it's another reason you want the double pipe ball other than increased attack. But if you go next to a pot, and you just quickly tap the pipe ball button, it for some reason it just duplicates your the pots that come out, the whatever comes out of the pot. I think it has something to do with it. The game registers that you hit the pot twice.
Yeah, it's two hitboxes connecting with another one, and it basically counted as two strikes instead of just one strike.
Yeah. You can triple dupe with a level 3 pike ball, for instance, or with a triple fire. You can triple your pots with that and get triple the money, triple the hearts, triple the magic.
It's a nifty thing when you're in a pinch sometimes. It really can help you. Alright, so we've delivered the deed to the Baron, which again sets up the events for Shantae and the Pirate's Curse, where he immediately moves in afterwards because he technically owns the town at this point. The freaking mayor sucks. He needs to be voted out, but you know.
Yeah, he set the whole...
It's too late. The village is too lazy to do anything about it.
Yeah, they don't care.
How much was the Skull Town worth? One chocolate?
Not one, it was just a box of waxy chocolates.
Yeah, right.
Dang.
Alright, so we're entering Battle Tower now. It's 10 levels of fun, and trials, and your knowledge of enemies. So, have fun with this one. I don't know really what to say about this particular tower. It just kind of is what it is. You're going to see a lot of pot duplication happening throughout it. I'm going to use it to get just a little bit of extra time to make sure I don't run out of time, because if you do run out of time in this, you have to start it all over again, and it sucks. You don't want that.
It also, I think, doesn't it delete or make you die, basically?
It does. No, you don't die. You just go back to the entrance, and it is what it is, so.
Yeah. One thing I'll say about this is that this is another reason the pipe ball really helps. I remember when I first played through this, I tried doing this as a fireball, not realizing at the time how useful the pipe ball is, and it's really hard unless you have the pipe ball to not only just to beat the enemies, but beat them fast.
Yeah, especially when they spawn in. Like what you're gonna see, or what you just saw there with that stone golem as an example, the pipe ball swinging through him as he spawns actually gives him more damage than he should have. So you saw that he just died like really quick, and normally they take like 5 or 6 hits before they actually die. So if as long as you can get over the spawn points of those monsters, it just makes it that much quicker to get through tower. So one of the little tricks that helps you just blow through this rather than the normal. So you'll see, like, it takes, like, a lot of hits to take these golems out, but that other one died really quick there. So I use that to my advantage dealing with these soldiers as well. Any and all advantages you can take with the pike ball, you definitely want to use them, especially in Battle Tower.
Yeah.
Wow, I did not grab the hearts. Okay, I've got more time than I'll ever need at 4:15, I think.
And Battle Tower is also like the main reason why we even have two pike balls, else we wouldn't need that in any way. Just to speed it up. And it's like 100 gems and a gem, or 150, it's...
Yeah, I can't remember like the cost. Nothing. But it's so invaluable when it comes down to the speed run.
Yeah.
Oh, get over here.
And because Solo likes to give us 100 gems as well, yeah. It helps. A lot.
And you're gonna notice I don't really care about Shantae's health. I mean, I do, to a certain extent, but... We're just basically gonna be standing in hitboxes to allow the pike ball to do all the work. Again, that's the main reason we've got it. It's basically gonna be our tank to get through this as quickly as possible. So you're going to notice I'm going to take a lot of damage, but that's fine. Again, between levels, you get plenty of hearts and fill-ups and everything, so you shouldn't have to worry about magic or health, regardless. Ooh, I'll take that magic drop, though.
So wait, are you on, like, floor 10 already? Or?
I am coming up on floor 10, yeah.
Alright.
Okay.
I know you guys are a little behind.
Yeah, it's like really hard. Sometimes it's pretty hard to commentate on this, like, because like the 15 second delay.
Yeah, I wish I could have set up the VLC, but I just don't trust my internet enough to be able to do that and do the stream at the same time,
yeah,
so.
Yeah, no, it's fine.
I'm just glad we're not getting a lot of baby rage right now. That's a thing on my channel.
Yeah. Or the airport.
Or the airport, actually, yeah. Where the heck are my Saturday flyers? The important thing is I finish the run within the next hour because they also do the tornado alarm test, so...
Oh, you're talking about... I'm like, what are you talking about? I'm sorry. Right. Yeah, so he has, like, his roommates have a baby, and he was telling us about this, but, like, sometimes they'll just randomly start crying.
Randomly? It constantly cries? What are you talking about?
Well, randomly, constantly randomly.
Yeah, constant randomness. Nice. That was good.
It's predicted RNG, let's
yeah,
say that.
Yeah, that's predictable RNG. I like the baby rage spam in chat. Thank you, guys. That's perfect.
Okay.
Oh, good lord. Alright. There we go. We done. We done with Battle Tower, yo. Let's move on.
Okay.
I'm surprised you're able to keep your magic.
It was
the whole time.
Yeah, that actually was really... I got a couple of really good magic drops through, like, random monster versions, so I'm not going to complain about that. That made that super simple.
Yeah. Very good magic management.
Alright, so technically you can skip this Rotita, or not Rotitops, but Risky Boots text, but it's extremely difficult. I've never pulled it off myself, and I just failed it again. I thought I'd give it a try, but it just doesn't work. Again, it's using the whipping as you're exiting a building technique in order to do it, and the window for that one is extremely tight. Like, I don't know any... It's one frame to really pull it off, and I've never been able to manage it, so...
It's basically because of that ceiling.
Yeah, you've got a very low ceiling there that kind of drives it. Another thing to just talk about, and unfortunately I didn't just have it happen to me there, but... when you're jumping and you take damage, you immediately lose all vertical momentum. Like, Shantae will just drop like a rock after taking damage in the middle of a jump. So yeah, you tend to drop into pits a lot because of that in this particular speedrun. Fortunately, again, I did not have that happen, but we're not out of the woods yet as we try to get through the rest of the desert here. The good news is at least that Monkey will cling to walls no matter what. As long as you hold against that wall, you're okay. So taking the damage there doesn't drop her all the way to the ground and lose a ton of time.
But while you're mentioning the vertical movement, yeah, it drops to zero the moment you get hit, so...
Yep.
Even if you're falling and you get hit, you start with zero again, so... You can get some distance as well. To sometimes not drop in any pits.
Alright, so we're gonna go back to Tangle Forest. We got this weird key from Barracuda Joe, and we're gonna go and figure out exactly what's supposed to happen. This game is really notorious for not telling you exactly what to do. It's probably more Metroidvania than any of the actual Shantae games at this point. I don't know, I've never really played the first one on Game Boy Color.
The first one is heavy in Metroidvania a lot.
Yeah, first one's pretty Metroidvania, but the third one is more of a hub world based type.
Yep, yeah.
Because you're traveling through ship. But yeah, you can see, like, it even has, like, multiple layers, which I wish they would do that. What they did in Tangle Forest, I wish they would do that more often, because that was a really cool thing. So he's gonna get... He needs the elephant, because one, it's about the same speed, not faster than...
Backdashing.
Backdashing.
Yeah.
And it also is required to get past certain parts, and to also get the monkey bullet, which he does need to get... He technically does need to get to, the third dungeon. Unless he wants to do, like, a frame-perfect trick, which you also would need the elephant for.
You can get through Lab 3 without Monkey Bullet. It's just slower than you don't
get
up.
You need to get to Coffee without...
Yeah.
That's what I was talking about.
Oh, wow. I wouldn't call that frame-perfect
I didn't even
either.
Think about that, but it's also slower through Lab 3.
Yeah. You lose time in Lab 3 if you don't have Monkey Bullet.
But, what was I going to say? So after he gets the elephant... you're gonna see him go talk to the skeletons because they're gonna make you get coffee, which is a huge running joke in the community because there's this one girl you need to talk to after you get the parts that a lot of people tend to easily forget.
I forgot it in the race yesterday.
Everybody forgets to talk to Sky at some point. Everybody forgets to talk to Sky at some point.
Yeah.
And all three games have it. All three. In every game, you have to talk to Sky.
Alright, so I'm talking to these zombies. These zombies are now giving me a mission, or otherwise they've threatened to go on a brain-feasting binge. So we don't want that to happen. We don't want our friends to be having their brains eaten. But I'm going to take a slight detour here and do the wrong warp.
Yeah, people are going to
be silent for that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sorry, I'm listening to audio cues for a minute. All right, we should be good to go.
You got it?
Yep, wrong warp complete. Yeah, so how could you guys explain how that or why that works really quick?
Why exactly is like, if you're off screen, there are other rooms loaded still, like it's a one whole map that is loaded in the background, and you only see a portion of it, like the one room that you right see, but the other one are loaded, and some of the doors are loaded as well. We don't know why there is a door to the ending of this game, but it is there and we found it, so we use it.
I think you'll notice there's a trend throughout when we're explaining Trish. A lot of this stuff we really don't understand that well. It just works, so we just kind of go with it.
Yeah, that's pretty much it in a nutshell. Like, there are tricks, they work, we don't know why, we can speculate all we want, we can't get answers, you know, it's a thing, but yeah. There's
only one thing we know of the wrong warp is, it is intended by the developers. We know that.
Oh, it was? Nice.
Yeah, they clearly said it is a way, this way is exists for a reason. We don't know why, but it exists, and that's all we got from them.
Probably either for testing or they actually just love us.
Yeah. No, they've come out and said that they love speedrunners, so you know, you can at least credit way forward that way.
I mean, I don't know if they would actually program a game just to like to specifically have something like that for speedrunners, but who knows.
Who thought that we can go out of bounds there, right?
Well, for those willing to try anything, which Esco, our main breaker of Shantae Games will always do. I swear he rubs on every pixel he can.
Oh baby, that sounds hot.
It does, that sounds super hot, but he does. He literally rubs on every pixel of every freaking Shantae game just to find everything. And I'm worried about my health here.
Oh yeah, this is a scary part right here.
You still have a potion.
Okay, at least I didn't fall in the pit as an elephant. Okay, we're good. I took no damage. But I'm going to use a potion when I get into the next cave, because if I take two falls, and I won't have the ability to do the death warp abuse, so I am going to drop a potion. I hate doing it here because it seems like a waste, but it's necessary. I am going to take this cautious.
Yeah, but when we're talking about Esco, we really have to say he found... many glitches in this game.
Yeah. He found many glitches in both Shantae, Risk's Revenge, and Pyre's Curse. I don't think he's found much for the original, but I don't think there's really much you could find in
that. He has that one out-of-bounds trick that if you touch the memory, you basically wipe out all save files, so...
Oh, that's...
You have to be extremely careful with that one out-of-bounds trick in the Game Boy Color one.
Does that actually work in a speedrun, though? Or?
It does. It is. It takes a while to set up because it's like you move one pixel at a time. You're basically using transformations to move within the wall. And then eventually you can turn into like a harpy and be able to fly out of bounds. But again, you start to see the memory blocks there. And if you touch the memory, you have a chance of wiping out your entire...
I don't know if he's the one who found that, but I think I know what you're talking about, but I think I saw it before he started looking for that.
Anyway, let's say he did a lot of, like, without him, any percent would still be at 30 minutes.
Yeah, definitely. Why is coffee in such a weird place? Because they want you to backtrack, that's why.
Yeah, they're basically, like, they're teaching you how to use the skills that you basically picked up at this point in order to be good at the game. Oh, damn it, I hate when I do that.
And talk to Sky, please.
Yeah, I'm on my way there now. So I just picked up that extra heart container, only to make, one, the run a little bit more safer, two, to see if we can maybe showcase at least one quick kill on these bosses. Damn it, menu with Sky, please.
Don't worry, there's one you have to get.
Yeah, I needed that heart because Hypno Baron, the next boss that I'll be coming across, I have to take basically a heart and a half of damage to try to do the quick kill on him, and I'm hoping we're going to get it because that guy is much worse to defeat than Squid Baron is if I can't actually get that to go. So we're going to be pretty aggressive on trying to get that. So I'm going to buy extra potions just for that purpose, and I've got those. So now we're going to make our way to do the coffee delivery. Welcome to we're about to do Mermaid Cliffs, which as a speedrunner, and I will just say this personally, I'm not going to speak for all of them, but I know Toucan is probably in the same camp as I am about Mermaid Cliffs. You're going to take damage and you're going to take a lot. It's just something you have to deal with. You have to deal with it.
Yeah, you like, get damage there.
Yeah.
If you can pretty much consider yourself, if you can get through this without like healing once, you're on really good, like you can consider that a really big achievement because there's like so much flying at you constantly. Because like you see his elephant right now, but he's going to have to like transform to monkey to get across. And he basically has to go through that part as a monkey for the most part because there's just so many small platforms he has to jump across.
Yeah, it's faster to do this as monkey. I mean, there is actually, I think we've timed it. You can do it quicker as Shantae, but you've got to be like on your game in order to do it. And God, these bats are being super freaking aggressive right now.
Oh, they're hungry.
Yeah, they are super hungry.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I forgot to feed them.
Oh, thanks, Trent. That's all your fault then.
Made me sick.
Oh,
I'm
surprised
you're not doing as many monkey bullets right now.
I try not to do the monkey bullet here just because it throws off my timing personally through here.
Yeah.
Like, I've got my own specific pattern. The bats will do what the bats do, but doing a lot of monkey bullet there doesn't work for me.
Please consider your health.
I did.
Okay.
No, I wasn't even saying out of that. I was saying out because your stream just froze for a second.
Oh, did it? I haven't dropped any frames. I haven't dropped any frames.
Oh, maybe I don't know. Maybe it's my computer.
Or maybe Twitch is twitching again.
Yeah, Twitch might be twitching.
Let's see. When was your last save?
My last save was
Squid Baron.
Yeah, I have not saved since. Don't worry, we'll rectify that really quick. I'll do it before I go into Lab 3. Since he's only one screen over. That's right, get dunked on, you freaking bats. Alright.
Yeah, exactly. Blame me for Mermaid Cliffs, please.
Yeah, it's all Trent's fault. Whoa! Hey, that was close, okay. Alright. And we are done with Mermaid Cliffs, at least the hard part. Wow. The kisses were real from those last three, though.
Yeah. The only sad thing why we can't speed up Lab 3 right now is because we need to get the last transformation, else we can't get a part of a key.
Yeah, it's kind of sad, but it is what it is.
If we could skip that part in any way, like go through that without the transformation, we would save 6 to 7 minutes.
For what? Going through Mermaid Cliffs, you mean?
No, Lab 3 alone.
Lab 3. Yeah, if we could skip Mermaid, it would save so much freaking time, but...
Yeah, I remember we were talking about it yesterday, but it's basically like impossible to do. Because it's like, you can jump into the water. There's certain parts of the game where you can jump into the water and then get across from under, like, there's, like, a platform blocking you from getting to the other side, but you can jump across. This specific one just isn't possible to do.
Cool, so...
This is, like, too low.
Alright, so what you guys just saw in Lab 3 was I was, again, using that, like, one-tile-high-space-whip mechanic to kind of warp myself to the first part of a puzzle for this particular lab. It fortunately doesn't put us completely out of bounds. It just kind of warps us within the dungeon, which is a kind of a benefit there. It actually saves me going through a little bit of a puzzle to be able to get to that particular part. And then you'll notice that when I grab that key, I also managed to get the key grab, which is a setup you can actually buffer to backdash the same time that you actually collect the items. So a little bit of a time save there. I've been trying to do them all run, but that was the first one I actually managed to pull off.
It's a lot. It's pretty easy to do with the key, but with heart holders and jams, it's harder.
Yeah,
a lot less of those.
Wow, I just totally got trolled by that damn jelly. What the hell was that about? Whatever. All right, so this vertical climb is the worst one in the game. These skeletons can be the worst nightmare, and they deal a lot of damage, so you've got to be extremely careful in order to not die at that particular part of the run.
I'm not even going for the time freeze.
No, I didn't.
It's for the eyes, for the viewers.
Do you want to explain it, Trent?
Let's say there is a glitch that can cause, because you can open in this dungeon, there is one door which can trigger a menu. And if you dance at the same moment you start talking with it, you buffer in your dance, get the transformation done, and then can still walk around even though the menu is open. And while any text box is appearing on the screen, nothing will hurt you, nothing will move. So you can go through everything on that particular screen. But it has some side effects, like very loud noise and that stuff.
Yeah. So if you... It's kind of a nasty trick, though. I think, Trent, you told me that it actually has some really nasty consequences if you don't do it right.
Yeah, if you do it incorrectly, you can soft lock. And I mean that literally. Like, you can accidentally go on the wrong door, and if you do that, Shantae walks and walks and goodbye. You have to close the game. You can't do anything against that.
Yeah, you don't want that to happen. So, all right, if you notice the eyeball thing going on here, there's obviously a very definitive theme with this particular dungeon. There are eyeballs everywhere. Certain eyeballs will change what certain doors do, things like that. And then you've got these moving platforms, which are just slower than freaking molasses, that you really don't want to deal with if at all possible, which is why we get Monkey Bullet for at least the horizontal rooms. So you're going to notice that I'm going to deal with these eyeballs as best I can. There's certain ones that I just have to deal with, but for the most part, we Monkey Bullet horizontally as much as we can just to get through this particular one. In the meantime, I'm now doing the 4 key grind, so that's going to take some time. It's necessary. We need these keys to be able to progress throughout the dungeon, so we're going to be collecting quite a few. The pattern at least is easy.
He's basically going to do, he's going to go into this room that shows a pattern, and then he's going to go to another room that looks similar, but he's going to put in that pattern. And you'd think you'd be able to like just guess the pattern, but there's been extensive testing on it, and basically there's no way to test. It's not programmed to open, even if you put in the right pattern, unless you went into that one first room first. So.
Yeah, way forward basically does this again in Pirate's Curse 2, where there's a code using three animals, and until you get that code, you cannot progress. Like, you cannot just guess the code or force the code and be able to move forward. You have to see the code before it happens.
Honestly, to me, that's kind of better than having to deal with RNG of guessing the code.
Very true, because it could take a while. In this particular case, you've got 4 eyes that you're dealing with, so the number of patterns, any math nerds out there will immediately calculate, you know, what the chances are. Oh my god!
Yeah, you have 4 directions by 4 eyes, so yeah.
Those spikes were not letting me go. Wow, that was interesting. I almost fell, but I didn't in left, your favorite room, Trent.
Oh, yeah, my favorite room. I fall there all the time.
You know, I almost did, but I saved it somehow, so... Oh, wait, I need to up.
Wow.
Yeah, those spikes were not letting me go at all, so... It's part of the problem with doing a forced damage trick, but, you know, is what it is.
Yeah. At the moment you get damage, if you don't hold right, you fall. In that particular scene.
Forgot which room you had to go into.
No, I didn't think I'd hit the eyeball when I did. I was like, oh shoot, I already hit that eyeball. It was when I went to get the extra heart, just for safety's sake.
This, him transforming to monkey is a minor time save, so he doesn't wait as long in some of these parts.
Yeah,
he is gonna wait.
You can jump higher, though.
Yeah.
In monkey, like, so it helps.
Do that. That's why I mentioned it.
Alright, so I got my four keys. I'm now going through the boss rush of doors. Oh, by the way, doors are the worst enemy in this game. We haven't talked about that yet. You're going to see here that I'm going to be standing in front of doors and wondering why it's not opening. And that's me mashing up until it actually recognizes I'm there. And can you guys remember left, down, up, right? Left, down, up, right.
Oh, give me 3DS. Oh,
okay,
wait,
I have it.
Okay.
Left, down, up, right.
Yep.
I usually just opt in for taking up camera with my 3DS.
Yeah, there's a number of different ways that people deal with this code. Remember, it's I just say it a couple of times and I'm good, but...
Left, down, up, right.
Yeah. For the people who are curious, it's 1024 different combinations you can have. Or 256.
Oh God.
I'm not 100% sure, but... It's way too crazy to even brute force that.
Nice try, chat. Too late. I'm already past that now.
Yeah. I noticed. I was like, oh god.
That's why I wasn't looking at chat.
Well, I mean, his name is Tumim forever. I mean, he's totally trustworthy.
Yeah, I totally believe. I totally would trust Tumim forever. All right, so here we go with Mermaid. The slowest land thing, but quickest way of going through water. Only way you can actually go underwater in this game is through Mermaid.
I think this is the only... Well, you use it only once in this game.
I use it to get out of this room, and I use it one more time to get the second half of the key to get to the boss, and that's it. That'll be the end of Sean Bay's Mermaid form.
Yeah, and the best thing about this, like, the way back, you don't need it anymore.
Mm-hmm. Well, because of the basically we skip through. There's a whole side quest that we skip, because of the category where you would get the mermaid bubble, and you have to like get Squid Baron comes back, and you have to get his squid babies, because reasons. But we don't do that in this run, so.
Yeah, I don't like babies.
Babies don't like you.
Yeah, I know.
You wonder when Half Genie Hero comes hits. We wonder too.
Yeah, we
all wonder.
Yeah, my money has been in the savings account based on pre-order forever, so.
I've been waiting for that game for 3 years since it was first kickstarted. It was supposed to come out in September, and it was also supposed to come out last year and the year before. You get the idea.
We just want to play it.
Yeah. It's been 300 years, man.
Yeah, and we will have a time up for Esco when he finds the first glitch.
Yeah. The second that game comes out, we put the timer on and see how long he's going to be like, hey, found this. Not sure how we apply it yet, but stay tuned. It's like, can you beat the game casually first before you decide to rip it apart? Alright, so now we got the second half of this skull, and I don't know how you use the skull as a key, but in the meantime, we're going to skip using Mermaid on the way out, because you actually can. It's one of the few times that you're able to jump into the water, be able to catch, the actual thing that keeps you from floating back up, and be able to move. So, just a slight time save in the ability to do that. This actually hasn't been a terrible Lab 3. I'm not going to complain too much about the way this has gone. That was a perfect drop, too.
Yeah. Like we said, only on the way in we need the mermaid, and that's the only reason why we even transform to mermaid. Get that whole thing.
Alright, so I'm taking the safety save before Hypno Baron, because, yeah, I need to.
Yeah. This guy, I mean, we mentioned this before, but the quick kills are frame perfect, and as you saw with Squid Baron,
it doesn't work all the time.
Yeah, and you can die really easily.
So, yeah, and the tricky part is, and this is one of my biggest problems with how quick kills work. Technically, you should be backdashing into these bosses, which really lodges you into their hitbox, but the monsters have this thing where their hitboxes will shift around based on their animation. So, in the case of like Squid Baron, he does certain things, and if you backdash in, you get caught by him. And then when you actually try to do the quick kill, you're not in his hitbox anymore, and it gets really annoying. So.
Oh, and also another annoying thing about this guy is that you see he teleports around a lot. So
RNG.
like if you weren't do the quick kills, you have to deal with it that like you have to try to hit him like while he's like zipping around all the time.
There it is. Got it.
Yay.
Great.
Wasn't perfect, I'll take it, but I only use like two potions, so we don't need to do any shopping.
I think without that trip or without quick kills, this is like a 3-4 minute fight
It is
easily.
easily a 3 to 4 minute fight, yeah. So yeah, as you notice, we basically just saved that boss's life. That was mercy, was what that was. He continues to do his thing, and we just grab the seal and get the hell out. So that's what a quick kill actually looks like.
Gotcha.
finally, at least got to show one. I didn't get to do it in my submission video. It sucked. I was very mad about that. But again, huge time save because as Madtez was talking about, that guy teleports around like crazy, and he gets faster like the more damage he takes. So it gets yeah, I got like six potions. We should be good, right? Yeah, we should be fine.
I'm not going to teleport at Mermaid Cliffs. Make me sick.
Yeah, I'm not taking Mermaid Cliffs. I'm actually going back through town, but I don't know. I just
Technically, it's slightly faster if you're like, but I was figuring it's usually good to do this if you want to make a trip, a shopping trip.
yeah, it's just ingrained in my muscle memory to just do it this way.
I think it's like 7 seconds faster, something like that.
Yeah.
It's not huge, so because you have elephant and you can simple dash.
All right, I'm gonna take this save here. Hopefully we won't need it, but now we're gonna come up to Mr. RNG, the boss. It's kind of the favorite, most interactive part of the things that we do in the stream of guess how many freaking anchors you're gonna get. You technically should only see up to, and I say up to,
Eight.
and you don't want to, but 8 anchors, yeah. Because he will do up to 2 per cycle, depending on what's going on. You
I know
don't
about
want to
six.
see that. Oh, great. Oh, okay, Shantae, please. Oh, there we go. Finally got the Yari zip. Wow, it didn't want to take. It was
The
weird.
Yari zip, is that what it's called?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I
because
don't know
you.
why we call it that way, but we call it Yari skip.
Yeah, everyone calls it the Yari skip, and I've had bad things happen with that, by the way. Like, if you do it in the wrong spot, it'll actually warp you back to the beginning of the freaking dungeon.
What?
It happened to me,
Hilarious.
yeah, it happened to me in a practice run yesterday. It actually put me in a
Whoa.
different part of the dungeon. I was like, what the hell? But anyway, here we go. We got Risky, and we remember this boss. Mr. Easiest boss in the entire game now becomes the most annoying freaking boss in the entire game. So we're gonna hope for the best here. Oh, right off the bat, no walk in a barrel. Holy cow.
Oh, that's great.
I will take that any day.
To put it in perspective for the people, this boss is like the gate for any good time.
Yeah, you will watch your PB hopes drain away.
Yeah, and you can't do anything against that.
Yep, because it's all RNG. All right, so we got 1 anchor so far.
Like 0 to 8 anchors is the time difference by 2 minutes.
2 anchors. And he'll walk right after, which is goodbye another 6 seconds. Yeah, mule. Yeah, mule. Yeah.
And the other thing is, no speedrunner yet have seen a zero anchor,
I could have
zero
sworn
walk.
someone seen one once. I think Devil Joe might have seen one once.
I
Or at
see.
least one.
I had a zero anchor, but I
I've
never
had
had a
zero.
zero
Yeah,
walk.
I've had 2 zero anchors in all of my running.
Oh.
But I never had zero walking as well. That's the problem.
Yeah.
like the perfect RNG. I never saw that.
Yeah, Taco, it is the funnest of all experiences.
So how many anchors are you at so far?
I'm still at 2.
Nice.
Oh, that's good.
I'm on 3 barrels and he's done 2 anchors.
Okay. When you are done with that, we are coming up to the end game.
Yep. So time will be coming up when we get into the Mega Shantae fight. I'll call it out. It's tricky because we're trying to do a frame perfect trick again to quick kill. Fighting her casually is a nightmare, and I'm not really equipped for it because it would be better if I had triple pike balls and a couple of magic potions, which I don't. So we're gonna basically do the quick kill regardless. There will be no resetting on that. If we die, we'll just take the save load, we'll deal with this again, and be what it is. So I will call out time when it happens. What we're gonna see is if I whip properly, the borders will pop up and we'll move on. So in the meantime, right now, Risky is taking away my magic and summons my magical half.
Yeah, no monkey anymore.
No more monkey, no more anything. Time.
Wow, that was quick.
Yeah, second. It might be sub 1 hour. I don't know. What's my time?
Yeah, it has to wait.
59:40.
Nice.
Wait, that's very close to your PB.
That is very close to my PB. Actually, I think it's like 4 seconds faster than my PB. So.
Wow. Wait, so you just PB'd?
I might have just PB'd. I'd have to take a look. I can't remember if I'm 59:33 or 59:44, but.
God damn it, dude.
Good job either way, man.
Yeah, it was really good. I got the last 2 quick kills that really mattered, so I'm very happy with that.
It was a 33, sadly.
Oh, okay, yeah, so almost PB, but not quite.
Yay.
Alright, well, you got any words to say to the people?
No, that's it, man. I appreciate you guys having this run. Shantae is always a fun speed run, no matter which one you're doing. I mean, I think this one's a little bit more difficult than any Pirate's Curse run, but it's rewarding.
I would say this category is probably the easiest out of the categories for this game.
Yeah.
If you want to look into this game, I definitely recommend picking this one up first, because it gives you a good feel of the game. And it's just, there's not really much to remember, except going through the route. I know Taco. He was really struggling last night, so it's really good to see he just pulled this one through.
Yeah, I had a really bad practice round last night, so it was good. But I want to thank all the Shantae runners, because they've been so supportive of me ever since I started running. I started with Pirate's Curse and learning this one, you know, Trent and Toucan and you, Matt Taz, being like the primary runners. Just thanks a lot for that. And then, of course, you know, the Degen group, thank you for having this run in the marathon. I greatly appreciate it. I'm glad I could run for you guys again. So hopefully in the future we'll get to do more. Beyond that, nothing else to say unless you guys want to see Bikini Shantae. There's no need to keep going. If you guys want to see Bikini Shantae, though, we got to wait for credits and it sucks.
Hey, the credits have good music.
I think we'll just be moving on.
That's fine.
On the schedule, it says up next is Wario World, but it looks like we actually will not be having that this marathon, so we'll actually be moving right on to Ape Escape 2 with Rekelch, so...
Nice! That's a fun run to watch. I love watching that run.